On hot copy this morning, warrants of arrest issued against actor Vong Navarro, one for acts of lasciviousness and the other for rape. Now joining us this morning to understand exactly what happened, we have Navarro's lawyer, Attorney Alma Malyonga. Attorney Malyonga, good morning to you. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Karen. It's been a long while since I saw you. I think it's been 8 years ago.
8 years ago, exactly. Mm-hmm. Now, just to give the viewers, I think, a reminder of what exactly this case is, an overview. In 2014, Denise Cornejo accused Vong Navarro, the host of Showtime, of attempted rape. But in 2018 and 2020, the Department of Justice actually issued resolutions dismissing these charges, correct? And then what happened? Let's go to that.
I think, Karen, we should go back even further than that.
Go ahead. Yes, ma'am.
Because we do not start with the rape allegations of Denise Cornejo. You remember that on January 22, 2014, that is the day when everything happened. On that day, Mr. Vong Navarro was the victim of a crime. Serious illegal detention and rape coercion. That's where we start. Mm-hmm. On January 22, 2014, in the condominium unit of Denise Cornejo, he was beaten up, he was detained, threats to kill were made upon him, he was videotaped, made to undergo a humiliating experience, monies were extorted from him, he was tied up. And his hands still tied up, he was brought to the police station for the purpose of placing in the blotter a supposed attempted rape. And the reason why that was done, it was made clear to Vong Navarro that was done so that he would not complain. He should only come across. They said, magbayad ka lang, mawawala lahat ito, magbubura lahat na ito. That's where we start, Karen. And then, of course, Mr. Vong Navarro, upon the advice of those who cared for him, and it was the right thing to do. If something horrible was done to you, complain. And it took a lot of courage on his part. He didn't want to do it. He was very, very scared. He was in the hospital, all beaten up, if you remember. But then he decided he will complain, and he did complain to the NBI. On January 28, you remember, he had an interview. Mm-hmm. He relayed what happened to him and what happened. Denise Cornejo and Mr. Cedric Lee also came out in media. You interviewed him, Karen, yes. You remember? And he said, Vong Navarro raped Denise. I saw him. He was on top of her. I pulled him from Denise Cornejo. That's what happened. On January 28, Mr. Vong Navarro finally formally filed a complaint with the DOJ for serious illegal detention and rape coercion. What happened? The next day, Ms. Cornejo filed a complaint for rape for January 22. And in that complaint affidavit that she made under oath and with the assistance of counsel, she said, I saw Mr. Vong Navarro 5 days earlier. He was in my condo unit. We had some conversation at some point. I told him, my girlfriend is not coming, so please leave. And he did. They had some bantering, and she also said, in fact, after January 17, we continued to message each other by SMS and by Viber. But on January 29, you know, by the way, that sworn declaration that there was no rape, she reiterated verbatim in another petition. Mm-mm. Same petition, same allegations. Mm-mm. But what happened on January 29? CCTV footages came out.
Exactly.
Making it clear.
Yes.
I just want to remind people, Karen, just showing to you this one single image of Ms. Cornejo entering the elevator just a minute, less than a minute, in fact, after Mr. Mm-mm. Vong Navarro left the scene. She was smiling, looking at herself in the mirror. She was very, very calm. And further footages will show that she walked through the lobby, talked to security guards, did not speak of any rape on January 22. Obviously, the allegations of rape on January 22 cannot be sustained. They are a distraction, a belated fabrication. What happened next? She was compelled by the DOJ to respond to the complaint for serious illegal detention and grave coercion. And what did she do? She reiterated in her counter affidavit, I was raped in January 22, notwithstanding this.
Mm-mm.
But then made another remarkable declaration. She said, remember, she had already said I had not been raped. In effect, she was saying, remember that thing where I said I was not raped on January 17? I'm sorry. I was raped after all. I was raped after all. Even if I said I wasn't, please believe me now, I was raped after all. And that essentially is what is at the core of the rape allegations of Ms. Denise Cornelio. A backtracking and a complete reversal of what she had already said before did not happen. Mainly, I think, because her complaint for a supposed rape on January 22 cannot simplify. What happened next, Karen? Her rape complaint was dismissed. In the meantime, the case for serious legal detention was filed. We have been litigating that case, Karen, for over 8 years.
Yeah.
4 years ago, she was already convicted along with Mr. Cedric Lee for the crime of grave coercion. Why? The judge said in his decision, there is no proof of any wrongdoing on the part of Mr. Bong Navarro that could have justified his being brought to the police station for the purpose of admitting to a crime he did not commit. What happened? Ms. Cornelio continued to file a complaint. She filed a second complaint, which was dismissed. She filed another complaint, a third complaint, which was also dismissed, not only by the OCP, the City Prosecutor, by the Prosecutor General, and by the Secretary of Justice. And the cases have been ongoing. What happened? What happened here was that after the cases were dismissed, they went up to the Court of Appeals. And I have to emphasize this. What is at issue before the Court of Appeals is not even the correctness of the dismissal.
Mm-mm.
Because under the law and jurisprudence, courts are not supposed to weigh in on determinations of probable cause by the executive department. In other words, what the Court of Appeals had to decide only was there grave abuse of discretion on the part of the Department of Justice? Not error. Was there meron bang pang-aabuso? No, was there any evidence that was not taken into consideration constituting an abuse? But there was none. And that is the case before the Court of Appeals. And that is the reason why we filed a motion for reconsideration.
Yes. Yeah, but this is what's shocking. I think this is what's shocking for the ordinary viewer who are not well versed with the law. All through these years of 8 years, the rape charges, the DOJ, the rape complaint, let's put it to simple terms, has been dismissed by the Department of Justice. And it is Cedric Lee, Denise Cornejo, and some of the companions that were found guilty by a court in Taguig for grave coercion, right? And for mauling and hurting Mr. Bong Navarro. And then suddenly you have the Court of Appeals issuing warrants for acts of lasciviousness and rape, the very charges that have been dismissed by the Department of Justice. So my question is, what basis is the Court of Appeals, what basis did they have to issue these warrants? Was there new evidence? On what grounds did they issue these warrants?
All right, but just by way of clarification, the Court of Appeals did not issue the warrants. What it did was in its decision in the dispositive portion said, we are hereby reversing the decision of the Department of Justice, Secretary of Justice.
Yes.
And we are directing the OCP, the gate, to file the information. But that's the kicker.
So that's my question. In other words, of course, it's the issuing of the warrants, but the reversal itself leads to the issuing of the warrants. So what is the basis for that?
All right. The Court of Appeals embarked on the proposition that if a woman says she has been raped, then she says all that is necessary for the case to proceed, and all matters concerning inconsistency and incredibility are supposed already to be heard by the courts. And of course, Karen, I have to say that to our mind, in our humble submission, that is not what the law and jurisprudence says. Uh-oh. It's not just, you know, if every woman tries rape and that goes to court immediately, then we would have a problem. And that is the reason why we have a preliminary investigation process where you have to find probable cause. And probable cause, while some say, well, it's a very low level of very low standard for of evidence, probable cause means in any event a likelihood. Mm-mm. Probability is not just a possibility, Karen, and there's also jurisprudence which says that in effect a preliminary investigation is a realistic judicial appraisal of the merits of the case. So even if you find that there might be a possibility of a crime, but if you file this case in court, the court will necessarily just have to acquit the accused, then don't file. And that's also the reason why, Karen, which is strange to me, the Court of Appeals did not say in its decision. Filed the case already. We had the remedy of a motion for reconsideration, which under the rules, by the way, Rules 51 in relation to Rule 52, the execution of that decision is stayed. That's why nakiusap kami sa Department of Justice, sa OCPDQ. Please hold off. This decision is not final. We have the remedy of MR. If you implement it now, that will render in effect both an academic, the remedies that we have. Unfortunately, when the cases were filed in court, by the way, Karen, when this case was wrapped, when the information for rape was filed, the executive judge, Olivetti, said in his opinion, this case shouldn't be raffled yet because there's a pending motion for reconsideration, which is the correct perspective.
Okay.
But for some reason, it was raffled off anyway. And then that's where we are.
Did the Court of Appeals, was there abuse on the part of the Court of Appeals in reversing the decision of the Department of Justice?
Well, in our humble submission, I cannot say that we do not think that the Court of Appeals was wrong, precisely because we filed a motion for reconsideration. You file a motion for reconsideration because you believe that the decision, essential parts of it, needs to be reversed. And that's where we are right now. And we are very, very, very sad and frustrated that process has not been allowed to play out. What do we do with the motion for reconsideration before the Court of Appeals then, when informations have already been filed? And worse than that, warrants of arrest have been issued. Yeah. In my humble submission, the issuance of the warrants of arrest are a nullity, not only on the basis of specific rules in place, but also on the precept of judicial courtesy. Mm-mm. There is a matter pending for the Court of Appeals. The Court of Appeals has said, Ms. Petitioner, comment on this motion for reconsideration. We are going to resolve this. But now we have filed motions actually before the courts to say, to plead again, please. Bakit tayo nagmamadali? Let's have the process play out. Especially in the case of the rape complaint, Karen. I still do not know what the basis of the court is for finding probable cause. We were not allowed yesterday.
That is the resolution.
We were not. We were not even given a copy of the warrant of arrest.
Really?
It was the NBI who was able to procure a copy of the warrant of arrest simply because they were already in Taguig to process the bail application of Mr. Navarro. And by the way, an interesting point. I was informed and I was shown the document where early in the morning of yesterday, Mr. Cedric Lee himself was in the Taguig court in the MTC to personally secure a copy of the warrant of arrest relating to the acts of lasciviousness. Shortly before the offices closed at 5 p.m., the RTC issued the finding, the warrant of arrest. It was around 4:30. We did not get the copy, as I said. We're going to get the copy now. And we do still do not understand how the finding of probable cause could possibly have been arrived at. And we're very interested, yeah, because of course, Karen, in both the RTC and in the MTC, we intend to do what we can, you know?
Yeah.
The strategy, Karen, I just have to say, we have a dilemma. Because we're very confident that there are no, there's no evidence to sustain the rape allegations. As I said, Ms. Cornejo herself has already declared that there is no rape happened. But if we file a motion for reconsideration, that might take time and that might delay the conduct
Okay, attorney, let's not get too technical because the viewers aren't lawyers. But I think let's simplify this. The shock on your part is what you're saying. The Court of Appeals reverses a decision that's been dismissed, right?
Yes.
So the Court of Appeals has reversed it with no new evidence. Is that correct?
That's correct. No new evidence
has been brought forth on the rape allegations, acts of lasciviousness, which has been dismissed in 2018 and 2020.
That's correct.
So in other words, no new evidence. The court does this on its own for the very reason that if a woman cries rape, it should be heard. That's the logic of the court.
Yes, that's the essence of the decision.
Okay. Number two, what happens now to Vong Navarro with an arrest warrant? He's now with the NBI. Is this bailable under the law? I'm sure you want him out on bail, but what is the possibility of that?
Well, precisely the MTC, the acts of lasciviousness, that was bailable. We were in the process of procuring bail. In fact, we got it.
Okay,
but the approval of the bail, the warrant of arrest with respect to the rape complaint was issued, and that case is non-bailable. Mr. Vong Navarro has voluntarily surrendered also in connection with the rape complaint, and he's presently detained. And under the laws and the procedure, he will continue to be detained until bail is granted to him. That will require that a petition for bail be filed, and we will do it immediately. And our actually requests, Karen, we are so ready. We are so eager to get on with this. If this is what we need to do, let's confront it. Let's just fight. My request is, let us not delay. If you are so ready, you're saying you can prove your case, go ahead and do it. Please do not give us any reason to delay. This is without prejudice, of course, to other remedies that we have, but our first and foremost duty, I think, in this case, is to set Mr. Vong Navarro free on bail. That's our challenge, and we are so eager to embark.
Okay. Attorney,
yes.
All right. Now, I don't mean to interrupt you. When a court in Taguig, this was in July 2018, when a court found Cedric Lee, Denise Cornejo, Jed Fernandez guilty of grave coercion, this was in relation to the charges filed by Vong Navarro against them. This is after he claimed that they had tied him up. They were extorting money from him. He was beaten physically. The court sentenced them to suffer a penalty of 6 months to 3 years maximum. And I think it says here in the decision, 6 months of prison correctional medium as maximum. My question is, how long were they in jail?
They were never jailed in connection with the grave coercion because they
never
appealed.
Okay. So do you not, but at some point they were detained, right? For a few months, I remember.
Oh yes, in connection with a serious illegal detention case, which is non-bailable. You remember Cedric Lee went to Samar and he had to be hunted down, and the FBI brought him. Mr. Vong Navarro here has voluntarily surrendered. He is so eager to face the charges.
Yes. Do you see this? Do you see revenge as a factor in this particular situation that Mr. Navarro is now facing?
A lot of people have spoken to me about that, Karen, but I have tried not to be enraged or to be affected by these opinions. Because as I said, my duty as a lawyer, first and foremost, to Wong Varo, is to keep clear-headed, to be focused, to be energized, and not to be distracted by any other thing, because whatever the motivations may have been, there's a legal process that is waiting to be played out, and they're so eager to embark on that. But it is true. It is true. So many people have told me about that, that this is just, you know, they just want Wong Navarro to suffer the experience that they had. That was what was told to me.